Howdy, how's it going? My name's Davy Chappie, and it's another day for another UA, and this time our lord the King Crawfish heard our pleas. But wizards, we cried, our eyes shining through the morning dew. We want the mystic! And the clouds parted as Jeremy descended on a ray of light, took our cheeks into his hands, and whispered softly in our ear.
No.
Yes, it seems that after the absolutely polarizing feelings on the mystic, as well as the general lukewarm reaction from the artificer, Wizards of the Coast have decided that they managed to satiate our voracious appetites for new classes enough, and that the mystic will be lost to the ether forevermore. In its stead, we will be getting subclasses devoted to creating a psychic alternative for players betrayed by the sudden loss of the most broken and janky class in 5e, with this article bringing the big think for the fighter, the rogue, and the sorcerer. As always, keep in mind that a lot of this is just my opinion, so if you feel sad about the mystic, I feel you, but you're never getting that class guide. But with that out of the way, let's begin. The Psionite is a revision of the psychic warrior archetype from way back in the November 2019 UA, and it pretty much completely rewrites the subclass from what it was into a new force of mortal nature propelled by powers bursting with psionic energy. This psionic power is represented by a D6 die that the Psionite can mold with their mind into a protective field for themselves or a teammate, a limit break on their athletic prowess, or an extra boost to their weapon swings. Later on, your power will grow to knock targets away when you hit them with psychically loaded attacks, and you can even move things with your mind. However, this psychic power is difficult to maintain, and if you roll the maximum on your psychic dice, then your die will shrink, turning from a D6 to a D4 to nothing. But if you roll the minimum on your psychic die, your dice will instead use the unused energy to become swole, and it'll go up a die step, from a d4 to a d6 to a d8, etc. Also, as you gain levels, your psychic dice will start out more swole than they used to whenever you take a long rest. Beyond the mood-swinging dice, your Psionite will enhance its metabolism to resist against poison and psychic damage, it will use the force to grant half cover to people, and it can use the real force to cast telekinesis all over the place. I gotta say, I'm very interested in this new gimmick that the Psionite, as well as the later subclasses in this article, have in regards to the psychic dice. Most of the abilities on this list can be used once normally, but can be used again if you voluntarily shrink the side eye, which is such a weird gimmick that I know will both be really cool when it works and really annoying when it doesn't. Having all of your gimmicks be tied to a resource that is constantly in a flux of availability is really good for representing the unpredictable and difficult nature of controlling psychic powers, especially since, through the power of probability, the smaller your dice is, the more likely it is to land on one of the numbers that'll change the dice. So it's a safer bet to just keep the side eye as high as possible, and it means that you'll have to be really careful about using any abilities that shrink that dice, lest you accidentally fall into the slippery slope of losing all your resources. The biggest gripe with the mechanic is that it'll be hard to keep track of if you're not on about it, but that's sort of offset by the other abilities being basic fighter stuffs. No offense to the developers, I'm sure you put a lot of thought into the abilities, they're just exactly what I would expect to see in a psychic fighter. Not overpowered, not underpowered, just milquetoast. The Soulknife Rogue is another subclass that we saw in last November's UA, and while it does come with a lot of the same old features, it gains the same psychic dice gimmick that the Psionite's been equipped with, this time letting the Soulknife add their side eye to rolls if they fail with a skill that they have proficiency with, and allowing them to establish a psychic Skype call with another person to speak telepathically with an amount of people equal to the roll up to a mile away. The Soulblades make a return, strangely not fueled by the psychic die initially. They instead act as a short sword and dagger combo that you can toss up to 60 feet. Eventually, you can boost these attacks with side eye to home them in on your enemies or toss them out and teleport them like you're the fourth Hokage, and you can also use your dice to turn invisible and slice through a person's mind to stun them. Considering that this subclass largely carries over abilities from the previous version, I'm happy that they installed the psychic dice mechanic into the old abilities instead of just pasting them on and not really caring much about it. Overall, like the last one, I think that this archetype is pretty well balanced, and I'd even say that it could get one or two minor buffs and I wouldn't be upset, considering there aren't a lot of combat-oriented abilities on this subclass, but I actually like the return to archetypes that don't overly rely on combat all the time. The only thing that I don't like is the rollable telepathy ability, because rolling for how many people you can affect makes the ability way too much of a guessing game as to whether it'll be useful or not, unless you're trying to only do it on one person, in which case, what's the point of the roll? I prefer if it were a flat amount of people targeted instead, and the roll could be for how long it lasts. Also, you can't name two of your abilities Psychic Blades and Soul Blades. That's like naming two NPCs Tom and Thom. Get out of here with that. Finally, the Psychic Soul Sorcerer replaces the Psionic Wizard, and honestly, that's fine by me. You know the wizard has too many subclasses, and psychic powers have always felt more like an innate ability, which is precisely what the sorcerer is all about. With the power of the psionic dice, you can form a telepathic bond with one other person, you can cast enchantment and divination spells that you don't have prepared, and you can wave the verbal, and possibly somatic and material, components of a spell that you cast. Past that, you can psychically enhance the power of your spells, you can channel both your psychic energy and your sorcery points to give you one or more abilities, including seeing invisibility, having a climbing or swimming speed, and becoming so pliable that you turn into jelly and just start squeezing through tight spaces as normal as 1 inch wide. Jelly sorcerers, rise up. Finally, your last ability lets you unleash your psionic energy into a bubble of bad vibes that hurts and slows everyone around you. So, a Of all the subclasses that I heard were getting psychic powers, the sorcerer excited me the most, especially when it dawned on me that the psychic dice was going to be the linchpin mechanic that the developers were basing all their hopes and dreams around. I was really excited to see how they played around with the fact that they were having the psychic dice share a bed with a class that already had a resource mechanic, and the result was... they didn't really. Sure, they had the one body modification ability that expends both psychic dice and sorcery points, but that can't be it. The devs have a golden opportunity to tie in two inner powers to a class whose whole gimmick is inner power, and they just aren't really doing anything about it. I expected to see something like sorcery points getting burned for bigger psychic dice being rolled to regain sorcery points, more abilities that pull from both resources or just either. I mean, sorcerer players who pick the subclass now have to manage their spell slots, their sorcery points, and the admittedly hard to keep track of psychic dice. They should be getting something big for their troubles. Not to mention that the psychic sorcery ability is poorly worded, and the ability to potentially wave material components is insane if it isn't specifying that the material components can't have a gold cost. No offense to the developers, I just feel like this subclass didn't get the amount of care that it should have. It just feels like it's going through the motion to check boxes. Now, the last bit of the UAs are spells and feats. The spells are pretty standard. Mindsliver is an intelligence save psychic damage cantrip that we should have had yesterday. Intellect Fortress is a 4th level spell that protects you from psychic damage and gives advantage on mental saving throws, nothing wrong there. And Mind Thrust is a 2nd level spell that does damage and limits the target to either moving or taking a single action, which I think is a neat ability that bosses will hate. As for feats, they're all psionic exclusive, that means that you either have to be playing a subclass that uses psychic dice, or take the new Wild Talent feat, which gives psychic dice to the dice list. Beyond that, it's pretty standard. Telekinesis and Telepathy make a return, offering you the same force powers that they once did, and the new Tower of Iron Will lets you use a reaction to add your psychic dice to a saving throw. But the feat that buttered my marshmallows the most was Metabolic Control, which gives you a bonus to a physical stat, the ability to shrink your psychic dice in order to remain fed for 24 hours like you just had a bike of psychic pebbles, and the ability to shrink your psychic dice to once per long rest, gain the benefits of a short rest in the span of a minute. This is massive for classes that rely on short rests, like the fighter and the warlock, and since anybody can be a psychic with wild talent, this feat is available for everyone. Luckily, you can only do it once per long rest, and it does shrivel your dice up a bit, but even if it's taking the spot of what could otherwise be a different feat or a stat increase, the ability to make all of your important skills come back in the span of a minute will leave the DM thinking that maybe playtest material is better left to the one-shots. But that'll about do it. I hope you enjoyed this video. Be sure to leave a like, comment, subscribe, check out my social media in the description below, and maybe support me on Patreon so that I can harness my big think to make the click-clack sounds in Biggin. But yeah, Davy out.